English form of transcriptical language. And because of that, you know, I got picked on one of my school records. Not because I was a tough guy with me, but just because I had the heaviest accent, like a real African accent. Like I sounded very African when I spoke. And you can imagine the jokes that went around, you know? So I made my business to learn how to speak English with no accent. Like I wanted, when you saw me or you spoke to me, you wouldn't even know I was from Africa. Like the bullying got to the point where I was even shy and embarrassed to be from Africa, because I thought it was a bad thing to be from Africa growing up because of being teased so much. And as I got older, all the light-skinned guys with curly hair used to be all the girls. And you know, I was a little dark, neck hair, accent. I didn't get no girls. So you can imagine the challenges growing up. And then, you know, as time went on, dark skin and black boy style. And I started getting more girls. But it motivated me because the whole time that was happening, I got support by women. And that's when I realized that women was the ones that actually moved and made things happen. Because things I couldn't get done, the women got them done for me. So that also became an element that I took and put in my backpack. So as time started moving forward, because of how all that stuff was happening, you know, the teasing and all of, you know, the lack of me being able to move forward because of my insecurities and things happening around me, I got into a lot of trouble, you know, put myself in positions I shouldn't have put myself in. But I felt like I was fighting back, but it was more physical than mental, you know. There was just a lot of frustration built up, and I was constantly getting locked up, coming in and out of jail. In the meantime, my dad was a jazz musician. You know, making basic, you know, jazz pay, playing in clubs, getting gigs here and there. And he never wanted me to do music. He always said, look, son, go to school, get a degree, be a doctor, be a lawyer. All African fathers want you to be a doctor or a lawyer. I know everybody that went through that. Right? So I said, no problem, Pop, I'll do that. Went to school, but I was singing. Playing pianos, doing musical stuff. I said, my dad's a musician, so why can't I be a musician? And ultimately, as time went on, every time I thought or spoke music, my dad was like, there's been music in this house. I'm like, Dad, you do music. He said, yeah, look at us. I said, yeah, look at us. See, now you gotta understand, I was very happy with where I was at. I was very content. Bills were paid, I had roof over my head, I ate meals, you know, 3 meals a day. So I thought, you know, what could be more, you know, worse than this compared to where we was living in Africa, where we was in the struggle, no electricity, no warm water, I was playing soccer with no shoes on. There's a whole other lifestyle. So I felt it couldn't get no better than the life I'm living in America. Whereas my dad had a better, or in his mind, had a vision for us that he always saw, that he foresee what me and my brothers would one day become. Naturally, you know, I'm just being naive and not knowing. I'm just living life and being a free spirit. Just, I'm happy as it is because there's no responsibilities at the moment for me. So as I graduated high school, because of my little, you know, juvenile record, I realized that I didn't get a basic job at McDonald's. Because the moment I filled out my application, and then there was this thing that said, have you ever been convicted of a felony or been locked up? I would naturally have to check yes because I knew they could check. Couldn't lie. So now it was up to the boss to decide who would give me that opportunity. And 95% of the time, they would just not call me back or give me a reason for not hiring. So you can only imagine what the thought process was at that moment. Now I felt like I had nothing to lose. I can't get a job. My dad don't want me to do music. I'm in a position of, what am I gonna do? I gotta make some money and I don't wanna be rich. I just didn't care how it was gonna happen. I was gonna be rich. Like that was the mindset I had in mind, because I didn't want my mom or dad to ever have something or ever feel like that they couldn't live a life that they always wanted to live. So I got caught up in a lot of miscellaneous crimes that turned into big crimes. And then I became an entrepreneur on the street and became actually very successful. You know, I had an anti-car theft operation where I stole cars and resold them. I know that sounds crazy, but it happened. And I had a couple of DMV connections, which were real innocent little women who I would call after I stole the car and said, I need you to register this car for me, and I got $1,000 for each car to register. So guess what? That was operation within itself. You get a highline car for a penny of the price, and then we make $10,000-$15,000 per car. So when I looked at it, I was like, well, Dad, I'm making about $100,000 a week. So the Mercedes is like $2,000 a piece. I got it paid, you know. It's legit, I got my DMV connection, you got a legitimate car, I got a couple of Mexicans that can chop it up at the shop. It's a win-win situation for you. But I'm not thinking about the consequences that comes shortly after. So I get locked up. And when I got locked up, I had this one roommate who actually was on his way to death, and he looked at me and he was like, man, like, what are you doing here? And I was like, man, the same reason you're here. He said, no, I'm here for murder. You in here for some bullshit. It's giving me the best that I have today. So you understand the dynamic. So I started Convict Music. He said, what kind of hell of a name is that? And why would you want to name yourself that? I said, well, it's more subliminal for me because I want to constantly remind myself of where I don't want to be. So every time I hear that name, it'll remind me of my turning point. So every time I produced a record or sang on a record, you hear these jail bars that go, shh. You guys remember those bars? Those bars was a reminder to myself that that's where I never want to go back again. So it created a subliminal thought in myself to where there was a wall that I had to put up on how far I was willing to go and where I wasn't willing to turn back to. So there was no turning back at that point. So to make a long story short, I created Convict Music. And what that did, at the time, it was a big fad. Huge compliment to be locked up in hip hop music. Like, he wasn't selling the record unless you were in jail. So I told everybody, I've been in jail for 30 years. The only problem is I don't look like I've been in jail. So I broke it down to 3 years. Honestly, I was only in jail for 6 months. But if you didn't beat it until I was in 15, 20. So I ran with the marketing scheme. I said, well, that's working. So let's ride with it, right? And under the company, I noticed that it worked. But not only that, but it gave hope to felons. Because felons ran into the same problem I ran into. When you come out, there's no opportunity. So there's really not no option but to go right back into what got you in there in the first place. So I wanted to help them. So I picked out any felon that I realized that had talent and could utilize that talent to create a better life for themselves and their family. So I started employing felons and then signing them to record deals. And through that, we found that artists such as Young Jeezy, T-Pain, I mean, it goes on and on, Young Thug, K-Pop. And it ultimately allowed them to become entrepreneurs themselves. And guess what? When I met them, they had nothing to lose and was willing to do anything. Even if it meant robbing you or running into somebody's house. And then rapping about it, knowing that the record would never sell. But because I gave them that opportunity, they had something now to lose. So a decision that they would make hanging on the corner of the block with their friends, they would normally, in a normal situation, they'd be like, all right, I'm with it, let's do it. But now they have a career. And a promise for long, and a bank account filled with money, and a family that depends on them. So now when that same idea pops up, and they're invited to something that they know they're not a part of, or shouldn't be a part of, they're like, nah, you know what, I'm cool. By the way, catch me when I get back. They will easily route to the left, and not go back the way they came in, because now they actually have something to lose. And that always followed me because I realized that my career was built on helping others build their careers. So I went on to just sign more people. And before you know it, it became an empire. You know, we found artists such as Lady Gaga, who became the ultimate promise to show, that even told me that this could be possible and things like this could actually happen for a normal person that came from Africa, got into trouble, became a convict. No opportunity, created an opportunity, and was supported by people around him and actually made it. Now utilizing that same support and putting it back to give other people support so they can do the same thing. And that's really what entrepreneurship is about. It's about growing. It's about creating and making something happen, making the impossible exist to be possible. So, I know the majority of the African entrepreneurs here, I can only imagine what it took you to get here. You don't even have to tell me your story, because I know mine, and it's not too far from yours. So ultimately, the key is unity. We gotta unite each other. We have to be in a position where we can communicate those thoughts, those ideas, and figure out where we can align each other's ducks and dot each other's T's. So if we don't come together with opportunities and ideas of each other to help each other's organizations and empires grow, then it only makes it, it takes a lot longer for you to get to the area where you're trying to go. So this brilliant idea of putting entrepreneurs together in one room, I don't know how to applaud that. There's no words to applaud how amazing and how important it is, especially in Africa. Because I always felt that in Africa, our biggest, ultimate, I could say, default is unity. I always felt that if Africans, if we could unite, just like really come together, we could grow a lot faster, and we could grow a lot stronger. But ultimately, of course, there's a lot of history in Africa. Our mother has suffered in so many ways that it's hard to really medicate it. It will never walk the same again unless we actually operate on it. Do our due diligence, create opportunities for these youth who will be their responsibility to move forward and take it to the next step. Because all we do at this point, we're literally running track. We have to pass that baton. But before we pass that baton, we have to at least get a small lead and give them an advantage. So just look at this like a big race. And as long as we're in the race, we can make it to the finish line. Winning is not really the purpose. The purpose is to get to the finish line. Because guess what? If winning is the purpose, we've lost years ago. We're 10 years behind in development. So obviously we're the last in line, right? But to our advantage, once we get to that finish line, we can now say that the world can, we can be a support system for the world. Because the world eventually is going to need Africa to be a support system for it. We have ample land, we have ample resources, we have ample people, we have ample youth, we have ample women, we have ample sun. Like, we have more than we would ever need. We just need to figure out and educate each other on how to utilize that to our advantage. And how not only does it help Africa, but how does it also enable the rest of the world to where Africa continue to be in a position to benefit from it? So even as we're out there thinking about genius ideas and creating new ideas and new partnerships around the world, let's figure out how it comes back. Because one thing my dad always told me is that life is like a hotel room. We're just passing through. So while we're here, what is it that we can do that not only will we be remembered for, but could be in a position to where it's sustainable forever? That's our biggest question today. Sustainability in Africa, and how does it develop in a way to where our children can keep going for us. So let's pass that baton. And I think everyone in this room is doing their part, and I congratulate everyone for being here. I congratulate the success. And I thank you very much for allowing me to be here and just to share that small little light, because ultimately, before I leave on Monday, I'm sure that there will be a number of people here that will be, you know, coming together and putting ideas that will change things. Like, it's so much that needs to happen. We don't know what role we are playing. We just know that we play a role. So let's continue to just do our part and not focus too much on what's being done around us. Let's figure out how we can do it for them. Because if we're in a position where we're always thinking, okay, I won't do it unless I'm getting something from it, nothing will ever happen. Just know when you do it, naturally, something good is going to come back anyway if it's done right. All be rewarded in the end anyway. Sometimes we get caught up in this life and assume that the great achievements that we do in this life is what matters. And if we don't get rewarded for what we put out, or if I don't get rewarded for what I put out, that is not worth doing. You know? Absolutely. So I'm getting the red flag, the white flag to cut this out. Because I could be here all day. Clearly. So I'm waiting the right way. Thank you for the morning. But also, let's know, in closing, I would just like to say that You know, let's do it in a way to be smart. Let's keep ourselves in line. Thank you.